One of the issues about navigation is there's kind of a toolkit. There's no one thing that exists in isolation. You're really looking at a combination of many signs that tell a coherent story, whether it's the stars and the sun or the wind and the cloud formations.
We have inside our minds a map of our surroundings, and we're constantly checking that map of our surroundings against our perceptions. What happens when people are lost typically is that that internal map doesn't align with our perceptions, and this causes great confusion in the mind and results in a state of anxiety, and that anxiety will propel them into doing stupid things. One of the tricks in getting unlost, if you're lost, is to have a strategy that aids search and rescue workers that would be looking for you. What I have here is some surveyor's tape. Tie it to a tree at about eye level, put your initials, and then a direction of travel. Move to another location, a Hansel and Gretel trick. Tie this around here, I mark my name and direction of travel. So a search and rescue mission may be walking through the woods trying to find me. They come across this tape, which tells them where I'm going. So instead of finding a dot in the woods, they can find a line of these markers and follow that line to me. You can set up a camp in some sort of a clearing, set up a fire, and it makes it incredibly easy for them to find.
Different clusters of people in areas will tend to latch on one or another scheme and elevate that scheme to prominence, like using stars as their primary reference. Vikings used the sun predominantly because the voyaging season was in the summer and the sun would rarely set. Other areas, other cultures will use wind compasses. So using the character of the wind, if the wind's blowing from the north, it's cold. If the wind's blowing from the ocean, it's wet. If the wind's blowing from the south, it's warm. So it's partly a product of the environment, but also partly a product of what people have found useful and taught others. And so it becomes ingrained in part of the culture.
There's an old adage that says moss grows on the north side of trees. In the northern hemisphere, the sun will arc from the east through the south part of the sky to the west. What will happen is as the sun arcs over the south part of the sky, the south parts of the trees will dry out, while the north part of the trees will be in shadow most of the time. Because they're in shadow, they'll tend to retain moisture and give favorable conditions for the growth of moss. It's a trick that works, but it has to be used judiciously, and also realize that there's lichen, which is different from the algae, which is different from the moss.
People tend to live in a bubble where they don't notice their surroundings. And even in the city, you can see major stars at night. You can see the sun in the sky. You can see the clouds going by. And we don't notice these things in the environment. What I teach to the students is to appreciate these in an almost intuitive way. And so what starts out as kind of a conscious, rational practice suddenly becomes much deeper, and you start to notice your surroundings a lot more. You look up in the sky and everything that we teach, the stars, the moon, the sun, the clouds, I mean, they're right there accompanying you.